So thank you.
Absolutely. Happy to be here.
Okay, so I'd love to start off with you and how you got to developing this company that we're sitting in right now.
It's a long story. You can cut me off anytime. I started in this industry when I think I was like 20. So I was still in college. I had made the switch to going part-time because I tried full-time and it was just too much academically with trying to work and whatnot. So I decided to go to school part-time and try to get a full-time job so I could afford car insurance and like the basic stuff.
Yeah.
And I happen to have a friend of a friend that's just said, hey, I work for this company. They're looking for, you know, new employees. If you want, I can put in the good word for you, right?
What a good friend.
Right, which is, you know, the way it works more on the East Coast. And so he did that, and I ended up going in for an interview, and I had no idea what I was getting into. And it was a job working at a semiconductor manufacturing company. They were making inkjet chips. They were in the process of going from semiconductor to kind of a more of a MEMS focus, which is what our company does today. Mm-hmm. So I started there. I was just making minimum wage. You know, I think it was like, I don't know, $7.10 an hour or something like that. And I honestly didn't think I would make it through the first, you know, couple of weeks. There was like a month training, and my first week I took a whole batch of silicon wafers, you know, probably like, $8,000-$10,000 worth of material, and dumped it upside down by accident. And I thought, that's it. I'm a goner. They're gonna fire me. but I made it, and I had a lot of people who invested time and energy into training me, and it was a great experience, and that's what started me in the industry. That company, you know, they got bought out. Their facility was kind of aging, and after a while, they decided like it was, you know, they started to kind of go down, and we knew it. I met my husband there, and he had gotten recruited out to a company, startup company in California, and so he ended up going there. And probably, I think it was maybe 2 months later, I ended up getting a job at that same company, and they were making all optical switch for, I think the target customer was like Cisco Systems.
Mm-hmm.
I was back in 2000-ish, where that was, you know, the height of like the dot-com bubble. You know, people were raising a lot of money at that time. It was an incredible experience. It's like what you think of like the typical, you know, tech startup. You know,
yeah.
We had beer and you know, champagne in the fridge and pizza every night, margaritas out, and you know, all in an attempt to get employees to like work as many hours as possible.
Yeah, exactly.
But it was fun, and we loved the startup atmosphere and the energy that came with it, and wanted to do that, you know, long term. Except, you know, it's a quick up and an even quicker down.
Mm-hmm.
Those companies typically don't last very long. They're tumultuous. There's a lot going on, and it can be stressful. And so we thought, gosh, you know, after we realized that we weren't all going to get rich and, you know, live on an island somewhere, we decided that we wanted something that was a little bit more stable. And so we started our own company.
Mm-hmm.
And we started by taking, you know, a lot of the orders that company had done, and we separated out into things that made money and things that didn't make money, and started to focus on those processes that we knew would make money. And that's how we developed our business model.
And then you come here to Southern Oregon, which, right, you came here to Southern Oregon.
We did.
Straight here, right, because you're here. Okay. Just to confirm we're in the right place.
Yeah, we are in the right place.
Which is kind of funny that you talk about like startup, like no one would think Southern Oregon startup. It's like Portland, metro area is kind of the thing.
Mm-hmm.
So what made you want to develop here and grow business here rather than where some might think is the bigger industry?
Yeah, it's a really good question. And we thought about, we thought about where we wanted to be personally, and then where would be a start a company. There was a really short period of time where we thought maybe Florida, right? Because
mm-hmm.
we had family there. We thought, well, do we want to move back to New York?
Yeah.
Where, my grandmother and my extended family, my husband's family was there close by. And ultimately, we knew it would be too expensive.
Mm.
And so we had family here in Southern Oregon. My parents moved up here in the early 90s. I was actually here for a couple of years as a teenager. I didn't make it very long. we had been up here for holidays and visiting with family, and it was driving distance. And we thought, okay, it is sort of driving distance. I think it took us about 10 hours to get from LA area up to Ashland. We looked around and we thought, okay, we could do a manufacturing facility here. The cost structure looks like it could work.
Mm-hmm.
The lease was, rents were relatively inexpensive compared to where we were. In LA you're paying a few dollars a square foot, and here was, under $1 a square foot for space. And so that's what we ended up doing. We made, we probably spent about 8 months driving back and forth.
Oh my God.
every weekend to every other weekend. After the startup company in LA had shut down, we both had gotten other jobs, and on the weekends, we would try to leave early and head up here around 3 or 4 in the afternoon, and I think it was probably 1, 2 a.m. we get here, and then meet with the the fire marshal and the real estate agent here on Saturday mornings.
Mm-hmm.
Until we got to a point where we identified the facility that we're actually in right now as the place we wanted, and started to build out network, figure out how we're going to finance the company. It was quite the undertaking. And then about 8 months into that process, I moved up and I started building the office.
Okay.
Working with contractors, trying to figure that out, and we were still working on financing.
Mm-hmm.
And sooner or later, we started kind of getting more together. We closed the deal on the financing, and I think by the time we sent out our first product, we had about $4,000 left in our line of credit. We had $60,000 in credit card debt, and about $15,000 worth of bills that due that month. So, it was rough for a while.
Well, I like that you bring that up, though, because that was something I wanted to talk to you about, is reading up on you. We talked off camera about how I don't understand how you get this stuff done, but you do, which is incredible. I was telling my husband, I can barely remember, what time church is, and you seem to be able to do incredible things, which is awesome. So I hope that some of it rubs off on me today. But you talk about, kind of where you found yourself in a startup. And a lot of people, there's a lot of people right now who want to start businesses.
Yeah.
And there's either two sides to it. They literally put all of their money in and find themselves in millions of dollars of debt and
mm-hmm.
can't get out.
Mm-hmm.
Or they're too afraid to even start something. And I know that you've been really active in the community and a part of the boards that you're on of helping people grow and figure out what they can do. Can you talk a little bit more about that?
Yeah, I think that's a really good point that you brought up, that it's kind of all or nothing, right? And before we started the company, I would look at CEOs and think to myself, how did they do it? How did they even get this done? Somebody must have given it to them, or they must have had a bunch of money that they inherited somewhere, or they were hired and then, something happened to the owners and they just disappeared and left them in charge. It's
exactly.
kind of mysterious.
Right.
You don't know. But the real stories of how companies get started look a lot more like our startup story, where, we put everything we had, and by the time we realized how difficult it would be, it was too late. as you start articulately mentioned earlier, the only way we could make it out was to work our way through it.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a big learning experience. It was challenging. It was exhausting. It was was probably the most difficult thing that I've done in my life, but we did it because mm-hmm. we had to.
Yeah.
And now, years later, I mean, we sent our first product out in late 2004. And so it's been a while. We made it to right up until 2008, and then bam, the whole collapse. I mean, we almost lost the company at that point. We had 12 employees. We were really starting to do well and think to ourselves, okay, like, this is doable, right?
Yeah.
We maybe have this. And that whole recession was, I still feel like a lot of anxiety over it. We went from around $100,000 a month in sales to $40,000 a month in sales.
Oh my gosh.
Overnight. Like in 1 month. I remember looking around, I'm looking through, you know, our QuickBooks files and thinking, did somebody forget to invoice something?
Yeah, exactly.
Like, I think we did more work than this, but
yeah.
It turns out, no, it was just a huge economic collapse, and we ended up laying off everyone, including ourselves. I think we had one employee, so my husband and I, we worked for free. We canceled our health insurance. We went to every single vendor and we said, hey, you know, here's what's going on. We're really struggling financially. Here's our plan to recover.
Yeah.
And we need 4 months of, you know, sort of wiggle room, right? If we can pay part of our invoices, if we can pay part of our rent. And we got our expenses down to something that we felt like was more manageable.
Yeah.
And then with you know, the savings from payroll, what we did was we hired one salesperson
mm-hmm.
and we restructured our website and started really focusing on connecting with the actual users of our product, whereas before we were working through what they call broker businesses where,
yeah.
you know, they have their customers are buying material from them, they send the material to us for additive processing, and then we send it back and they pass it on to their customers. So we didn't have a direct link
yeah.
to our actual customers. And we executed that plan, and I would say 4 to 6 months later, we had hired back the people that we could. And
oh my gosh, that's awesome.
And, you know, we were able to continue moving forward. But, I mean, there were nights I was up. You know, you're using you pay out payroll, you know, you pay out whatever you can, and then you hope and pray that money comes in the next day
yeah,
to fill
yeah.
that bank account
yes.
before someone cashes the check. So it was like that. It was touch and go for a while. I would say we didn't feel like we really recovered from that probably until 2014. I mean, it was
wow.
a long time.
And, you know, I kind of had this for later, but I'm really loving what you're bringing up of trying to make things work. A lot of small businesses right now, especially in Oregon, but all over the country,
yeah.
are going through COVID and lockdowns. It's something unexpected. So you're talking
yeah.
about 2008. No one really expected that. Some people may have saw it a little bit, but it's one of those things where you go from just chugging along and everything's awesome
yeah.
to just your whole life halts, and you have to completely pivot and try to figure something out. And a lot of our businesses are going through that right now.
Oh yeah. I didn't know how this was gonna work out. Back in May, we saw companies like even in our industry completely shut their doors. I remember talking to a customer and they were like, the county just called and evacuated our entire building. They were
oh
in Santa Clara County. They called every phone in the office and told people they had 1 hour to leave.
Oh my goodness.
They didn't have any way to remote in to even do payroll. So it was sudden. It was really extreme circumstances, and I feel so badly for people that weren't able to continue working like we were. We
yeah.
were deemed an essential business because of the type of work that we're doing. But so many restaurants and gyms and people have put everything like we did into what they know and love to try to build a life for themselves were just completely decimated.
Yeah.
And, you know, we thought, okay, you know, a couple months, you know, to figure out what this is, because no one knew what COVID-19 was.
Exactly right.
We didn't know anything about it.
Mm-hmm.
Let's figure out what it is. Let's figure out what therapeutics work on it. Let's get going on, you know, trying to figure out what kind of vaccine will work for this, if that's even possible.
Yeah.
You know, what treatments are going to be effective? Who is most affected? And I think that has been the scariest part, is that we just don't know. I mean, we've had young people that are impacted severely. We have elderly people that are, you know, fine in some ways. So it was a really scary time. But I believe that we could have probably handled things better, allowed companies to open up a little bit sooner if we had been more strategic with how we managed our resources. And but, you know, I think people did the best they can with the information that they have at the time. And, you know, history, when we look back on this, you know, we're going to see where those big mistakes were and where we could have done things better.
Yeah.
And hopefully learn from that.
Well, you talked about strategy. Again, I'm kind of shifting things up because I think we've just gone in an awesome direction.
Sure.
What have you seen tech companies shift to in COVID-19? What are some strategies that you've seen companies try to implement to either help the current situation or just pivot what they're making?
So really all over the board. I can tell you from our perspective, and we're a little bit unique.
Yeah.
We had many of our customers, we do some work on the biotech side. I should start with that.
Yeah.
So we're working with customers that have technology for monitoring for certain diseases that are, you know, they have tests that they're developing for different types of bacteria or cancer diagnostics, things like that. Those companies, we started pretty quickly to get phone calls saying, hey, we think that our platform technology, like our core technology, might be suited for doing point of care rapid testing for COVID-19. We need you to, you know, expedite this next batch of work that we're sending to you,
mm-hmm.
So that we can test those chips and see if we qualify for that emergency use authorization through FDA, things like that. So that became pretty transformational. We saw a big loss. We also do work on for public universities. So a lot of those shared facilities were completely shut down because they're part of that public infrastructure.
Mm-hmm.
So companies that were doing research in those facilities, they weren't able to get access to that. So we saw a big part of a section of our company just kind of go dormant, and then got flooded on the other side with a lot of these specialty projects. And so it was an exercise for us in really figuring out how to restructure the way we tackled the work that we have, because the mix was really different.
Yeah.
How do we, you know, get employees trained in very specific areas so we can start to push some of these projects along, because we knew how important that technology might be later on. A lot of companies were doing really similar things, and some people just pivoted completely. There was a local company here that, you know, they started off doing one thing. Their business was, you know, coating lenses, and they use a lot of different types of chemistries. They shifted their business completely to making hand sanitizer.
Huh, yeah.
I mean, just overnight. And so, you know, we've got an incredible community of entrepreneurs that, when you have to, you know, you get creative and you do what you have to do. But for those who I think are unable to stay open, that became much, much more difficult, you know. So you saw restaurants getting creative about takeout menus and trying to hone in on efficiency and trying to do what they could to support, you know, their local community. I mean, we had fires that broke out during this whole COVID thing down here. We also had, you know, we had almost two cities burned to the ground. Talon and Phoenix were severely impacted.
Right.
And those same restaurants that were shut down stepped up to the plate to deliver food to needy families and first responders. So, I mean, we have a really incredible community all across Oregon of really creative, exceptional entrepreneurs.
Yeah, I've never been more proud of my community. I think 2020 brought on a lot for everybody. Whether you were affected by shutdowns or job loss or however it came about, for me it was like, while it was troubling times, it was also incredible to see communities be brought together, and the fires was a huge example of that.
Yeah.
When I went to volunteer, and at the expo, they were like, we have too many volunteers, like, stop coming. And it was like, oh my gosh. And so then I went to go make food for firefighters, and they were like, firefighters are complaining that they have too much food. And you're like, what? This is awesome.
Yeah.
So I agree with you. It's seeing communities come together in whatever industry is incredible.
Mm-hmm.
I want to talk about, just to pivot a little bit, you also have done a lot of speaking engagements with like women's events,
mm-hmm.
and things like that. You also did a TED Talk in Ashland, which I had no idea that even took place. So
isn't that cool? I had a TED Talk in Ashland.
I was like, what? kind of pivoting a little bit. We're talking a lot about business.
Yeah.
In business, there's a lot of the middle class. And in your TED Talk, you talked about the death of the middle class, which is pretty impactful, but if you could expand on that a little bit more, that'd be awesome.
Sure. I have seen over my lifetime just a real stagnation where people aren't able to get ahead.
Mm-hmm.
Where even if you're working, it's really tough. And a lot of that is the people who are most impacted are single parents.
Mm-hmm.
Parents
yeah.
who have two or three kids, they had to go through a split up with their partner, or something happened, and they are now the sole breadwinner, and it's very, very difficult for those people to build careers, let alone move forward financially. And so what we see is people kind of sitting at this just above, the water level, right at that poverty line, and then a lot of other people doing exceptionally well. And so there's this big disparity there. And when I started to really look at this issue, what I realized is that we have incredible safety net systems, especially in Oregon. I mean, we're really exceptional in that area, but what happens is it really becomes a trap. So instead of helping people, we're keeping them just right there, just good enough to, where they can, put a food on the table. They maybe can get some childcare, they can afford to sort of survive, but they can't afford to thrive.
Mm-hmm.
What I'm referring to is the benefits cliff. So if you're a single mom, you got two kids, you're getting a childcare subsidy, you have SNAP, which is food stamps, you might have some housing assistance. If you get a job, let's say you're making $15 an hour, you start working full time and maybe get a little overtime, that's it.
Yeah.
That drops off. That support system is no longer there because now you don't qualify because you make too much money.
Yeah.
And so what ends up happening is people keep their hours low. They maybe don't work at all because then they can be home with their kids. Because even if they do work, they're now upside down in what their total amount of resources are. I had a girlfriend that this happened to, and she told me, she's like, you don't understand, it's a trap. Once you get on those services, it's so hard to get out because there's no ramp. As soon as you start to do well, you end up upside down. And I actually did the math, and it's negative like $500 a month. I mean, it's significant. And so the TED Talk that I did was calling attention to this and really looking at, the issue and then what we can do about it.
Mm-hmm.
And so So one of the concepts that I think would be really effective is doing a payroll offset.
Yeah.
So that as you start to grow in your career, you know, there's small, you have a small piece that comes out as part of your taxes, right? It goes back into the fund, but you're allowed to stay on those services as you grow out of it.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we need to be, we have the capability now. I think when those systems were designed, we just didn't have the digital infrastructure to maybe make that work as smoothly as we can now.
Yeah.
And it's time to restructure some of those things so that people can actually, you know, build a career, take care of their kids, and not be dependent on the system till they're 45.
Mm-hmm.
It's an absolute must. And I think if we can do that, we'll have a growing middle class again.
Yeah, and we're losing that, as you said.
Yeah.
It's like we're seeing either extreme poverty or extreme rich, you know.
Yeah.
It's like, or extreme wealth, I should say. And it is a disparity that has to be addressed. How we go about doing that is an interesting conversation. Rounding back to you helping women in the community, what does that look like when you're having these conversations with women? Is it start a business? Is it stay home? What's the conversation? Because that seems to be the either one, right? It's either you do this or you do this.
Well, and I think it's even more of an issue now that schools are closed.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, we have women that have great careers that are now leaving the workforce because they can't figure out, even working from home, they cannot figure out how to be a good parent and how to help their child in school, how to keep them on track academically, and also do their work. It's too much. We, as parents, it's just not, you know, you've got a Zoom going on, a child that, you know, falls off a chair, hurts themselves, and a conference call of your own going on. I mean, it is not possible to do all of that without help.
Yeah, exactly.
And so, you know, we're seeing more and more women leave the workforce. And it's a problem. We need, right now, we need as many people in our workforce as possible. We still have companies, even with this kind of interesting sort of shutdown in the economy that we have right now, there are a lot of job openings, but people aren't able to take advantage of them in a lot of ways because they cannot figure out how to juggle family. So specifically for women, I think, and for, you know, moms and dads, I think that we should be working on changing the culture around work a little bit, right?
Mm-hmm.
I think that family-friendly offices are perfectly okay and actually healthy for the entire family and the employees, right?
Mm-hmm.
When your children see you working and contributing, I mean, that's an example to them that they won't see unless they come and see you at work.
Mm-hmm.
And so for here, like in our company, I mean, we have, you know, bring your child. If your kid is not in school, bring them, you know, they can stay in the conference room, they can hang out at your cubicle, they can walk around with you. We really encourage people to not sit out, but contribute in whatever way they can and try to give that flexibility. When I had my two babies, they were here. I actually had two home births.
Okay.
and so I was very, you know, sort of untraditional in that way. And I came back to work. I tried to stay home. I thought I would be home for a month or, you know, 6 weeks or something.
Yeah.
And babies sleep. They sleep like 24 hours. not that much. Maybe like 18 hours. When they're first born, they're really teeny and they only wake up to eat. And cry, and you know, the other thing. And so there was only so much TV and stuff I could watch. And so I came back to work 4 or 5 days later.
My
Easy Up and my, you know, all my stuff. And I had baby, and I was typing and on the phone and, you know, nursing and doing all that stuff in the office. And both my kids were talking by the time they were like 18 months.
Yeah,
right?
Exactly.
They had all this interaction. It was wonderful. And so I think that the what I would encourage women to do is think outside the box. Think about, don't let motherhood be a barrier to you. You know, you need a supportive partner. It's always helpful, but you can build a career, have a family. I mean, you really can do a lot. I mean, we are really capable, and there's support, you know, that you can structure for yourself. And don't be afraid to get out there and to try, because you just don't know how it's going to end up. And I think having moms that are actively participating, that are building their careers, are just such an important example to kids. It's it was a phenomenal experience for me, continues to be. I think that motherhood is the perfect kind of catalyst to become an entrepreneur, right? You know, your schedules are shifting, and you know, you can really make things happen in a non-traditional way, and it could be really great. I would also say that it's a lot of hard work, but it's worth it. It is so worth it.
That's awesome. Well, getting into the cultural talking points a little bit, you are a female entrepreneur.
Yep.
Okay. And so how has you being a female entrepreneur played into what you've helped create? I mean, I know you created it with your husband, so it's not just you, but it is pretty incredible to see a boss lady getting up every day and managing this. So what has that been like for you to build this business?
I would say at first I was shy. I really struggled with identifying myself as the CEO of a company, and I remember going to a conference, and I ran into a friend, and he said, "Oh, you started your own company," and he said, "Let me see your card." And so I gave him my card, and I purposely did not put a title, and he gave it back to me. He's like, "I never want to see that again." He's like, "Where's your title? You're CEO." And I said, "Well, but I'm not CEO of anything. I'm CEO of nothing, right? Yeah. We haven't done anything yet." And he said, "No, you're a CEO." And that stuck with me, and it's, you know, it's in our industry, we're very male, we're more male dominated.
Right.
I mean, we're getting a lot more women involved now, but traditionally it was, you know, it was, I would go to a conference and it would be me, maybe one other lady engineer, and the staff that was running the conference, right?
Mm-hmm.
And 3 or 4, maybe 500 men.
Yes.
But the benefit to that is that you're so memorable. People, you stick out like a sore thumb. And, you know, you can take that and it can be really intimidating, or you can turn around and you can use that to benefit your company. And so I chose to, like, try to put my anxiety aside and put my fear aside and do what I thought was best for the company. And that meant getting out there and building the network. Not being intimidated by that. I also don't have a technical degree. I never finished college, actually. I have a 2-year associate's degree from community college.
Oh my gosh. That's even more amazing.
And so for me, you know, it was, you know, I'm always like shy about that part. And, you know, it's been like a sore point in a lot of ways for me. You know, you get up and you speak on a panel and, you know, everybody thinks you're this wonderful, educated person, and then you have to admit, oh no, by the way, I didn't go to Stanford like everyone else in this room, you know. But there's, you know, I learned a lot along the way, and I've had some incredible, incredible mentors that have really pushed me out of my comfort zone. And it's been challenging, it's been rewarding. I've for sure experienced like every version of sexism, right, as part of that. But I think it's pushed me to be a more effective leader.
I think that's awesome. So another cultural talking point is sustainability. There's the idea that to be sustainable, you kind of have to live in a commune, and everyone just kind of like, I don't know, only wear hemp or whatever. I don't know. Clearly that's not me. but that seems to be the topic of sustainability. But sustainability can move and flex.
Yeah.
With your industry and stuff that I've seen on your website and everything, you really push for sustainability. What does that look like in your industry, and how do you accomplish that?
I love what you say about that stereotype, because I think that's true for a lot of people. They feel like, you know, sustainability is all about the earth, and it's, you know, and yes, it we need to be environmentally responsible, but it's also about resiliency and resiliency for our communities. Tech companies, and especially those who are developing products, like we help our customers develop new technology that's going to be commercialized and exported to places all over the world that has the added impact of improving quality of life, right? Mm-hmm. So how do we do that as a business community without compromising the planet? And
yeah.
I think that's really what it's about. And there are so many amazing things that you see going on in the tech development area that, you know, with battery technology and just reducing energy uses in general.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if I was to look at things that are going to be really impactful for our business community in Oregon to do, it's focusing on that research and development side. How do we make better and more efficient use of the energy that we have? How do we store it? Right?
Yeah.
We have ways to collect energy,
yeah.
But the storage is still a problem. And so there is some really great work going on around that area. We really should be tapping into, and I think we are to some extent, the brain trust that our universities bring in this area. And that once that technology is developed, I mean, you export that to areas that are really, really struggling to you know, get their air quality in line. If you've ever been to parts of Asia, I was in Shanghai right before the pandemic, and I remember looking out my hotel window and I couldn't see the sidewalk. There was such a dense smog and pollution that, you know, you sort of saw a person and you think kind of walk by, and it was like this cloud of brown. You know, they need help to figure out how to create a regulatory system that is effective, that works, but it still allows them to compete and do what they need to do as a country. But we, in a lot of ways, the United States is an important contributor from a technology perspective on how we actually deliver that technology. What is that up and coming things that we can do to work towards more sustainable practices, to keep air quality clean, to keep our water clean, and be the best stewards of those natural resources that we have available.
Well, and doing it in a way that makes sense, because I know I keep bringing up the different talking points, but I think they're important, because a lot of people are like, well, then we remove cars, we remove all plastic, we remove whatever, and it's like, okay, well, maybe one day. It's not sustainable right now, so what can we do? And you're talking about other countries, even in LA. You go to LA and you come over the mountains,
it's
just
smog,
and you're like, oh my goodness. But you know, sometimes relying on some of the technologies that we have right now clearly aren't cutting it. So what are some new innovative ways is the talking point. But that probably might be a whole separate.
We could do a whole hour on technology and clean energy and all of that stuff. It's fascinating. It's really amazing what industry has been able to do to really make headway in that area. And you know, we're going to continue working on it. I mean, there is a lot of energy towards that. I think it's important. But what we don't want to do is weird stuff like cap and trade, which just it's not effective. You know, I'm all about, I mean, we need to address these issues, but we have to be practical about it, and it has to make sense. And we want to make an actual real impact, not just make things more expensive. Right?
Exactly.
I think that's the message, is how do we use what we have to be most effective?
For sure. So before we wrap up, because I know we've gone over a ton of conversations, I've kept you here probably longer than I should have, but what do you want people to take away from what you're doing here in the community? Is there anything upcoming that you want to tell people about in what you're developing or anything on the side that you're doing as well?
I would say that the biggest thing and what I really want to see people do and business owners do, and they do, is take all of that energy that you have in your business and go out into your community and encourage kids to get involved, right?
Yeah.
We need a thriving workforce that is going to carry Oregon into the future. And we have a lot of kids that are struggling. We have a lot of adults, young adults that are kind of in limbo land. And I remember that feeling, how that, thinking back to, when I first got that job in the semiconductor industry, thinking to myself, how am I going to support myself?
Yeah.
What is my future going to look like? How am I going to pay rent? How am I going to pay my car insurance? It's a scary time. And I think that there's a lot that business owners can do to help highlight that path and to be really open about how they started their companies. What are sort of the mechanics that they went through for funding? Because it seems mysterious, like we talked about earlier, like the CEO that, just got handed a whole pile of money.
Yeah.
The reality is it doesn't really work like that,
right?
For small business owners. And we can do a better job at being open and highlighting that for people that are coming to the workforce and showing them that it is possible. They can do well. We need them to do well.
Yeah. That's awesome. Well, thank you so much. This has been so cool. Okay.
You're welcome.
Well, thank you. Thank you for meeting me today. I really appreciate it.